It's on, yes. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. If I could have your attention, then we can start with this afternoon's lecture, which will take us to a part of our world that perhaps some of you have already explored, but I'm sure not as deeply and as deep as Professor Alex Rogers has done. I was just asking him how deep has he actually gone in terms of exploring the depths of marine life in the oceans, and he just confessed 3,300 meters. So that's a pretty impressive depth at which to look upwards and sideways and speak to what is the theme of this particular lecture, exploring our inner space, discovering the deep sea, and assessing human impact. This is the third event in the Hilary Term lecture series that we have baptized New Frontiers, Pushing the Boundaries of Science and Technology. And I'm particularly grateful to Alex for having agreed to be our lecturer for this evening. Just to advise you, the hashtag for the series is hashtag OMS Frontiers, and the lecture is being filmed and live webcast. Let me just say a couple of words to introduce you, Alex, if you don't mind. Many of you would not be here if you did not know about him and his work already, but Professor Alex Rogers is currently the co-director of the Oxford Martin Program on Sustainable Oceans, and in the rest of his long days and short nights, also professor of conservation biology at the Department of Zoology, a fellow of Somerville College, scientific director of the International Program on the State of the Oceans, and also director of the Oxford India Center for Sustainable Development. I smiled when I read about his current research, and I was just teasing him because it is along two frontiers, the ecology and evolution of deep sea ecosystems and shallow water coral reefs and human impacts on them. So he's got it all covered. And obviously, Alex, we very much look forward to the journey we can take with you this afternoon. So a warm welcome, and the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thanks, Akin. I thought I'd start with a short film which introduces really a new project that we're undertaking at the moment, and also is quite a nice, if slightly hyperbolic, introduction to the deep ocean.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Our economies, our livelihoods, and our food all depend on our oceans.
The Great Barrier Reef is dying.
They are literally destroying the reef wholesale.
Systematically devastated our global fisheries through destructive practices.
Government scientists sounded the alarm about coral.
And the oceans are in trouble.
Leading us to unprecedented damage to the oceans and the animals living in them.
NOAA believes 5% of the world's coral could be lost this year.
As much as 8 million tons of plastic waste enters the oceans every year.
We confront an urgent choice.
We are tied to the ocean. And when we go back to the sea, we are going back from whence we came.
Here's the challenge. The deep ocean is the most critical part of our planet, yet it's the least known. We have better maps of the Moon and Mars than we do of our own seabed. So how can we sustainably manage and protect the ocean unless we know its function, its health, and its value to us?
The big problem we have with understanding the deep ocean is we simply don't understand the distribution of life within it. The fastest way to change that situation is to develop a series of global ocean expeditions from 200 meters down to 2,000 meters, which we call the Bathyal Zone.
The Bathyal Zone is home to the greatest diversity of species anywhere in the ocean and contains all the critical indicators of ocean health. It performs an essential role for the planet in absorbing carbon dioxide and regulating climate. But with its wealth of oil, gas, and fish, it's the region most vulnerable to human exploitation. It's clear we need a major step change in our understanding of the deep ocean.
Okay, so that gives you a very brief introduction to where we spend a lot of our time working. The deep ocean is the biggest ecosystem on Earth. We're dealing with about 1.3 billion cubic kilometers of water. The average depth of the oceans is about 4.2 kilometers deep. And as you can see here, about 88% of the oceans beyond continental shelves are deeper than 1 kilometer, and 76% are 3 to 6 kilometers deep. And this is the way we sort of divide up the ocean as biologists. We have the water column, known as the pelagic zone, and we have the seabed. And we divide that up by depth. So the upper sunlit waters, known as the epipelagic zone, is where most of the food production in the ocean takes place. Then we have the mesopelagic zone, where some sunlight is detectable. And finally, we enter the dark ocean. And likewise, the seabed, we have this very narrow continental shelf zone down to about 200 meters, the continental slopes, abyssal plains, and finally the trenches, which go down to nearly 11 kilometers deep at their greatest extent. We also divide up the oceans in terms of human regulation. And the main division really is between the exclusive economic zones around coastal states and then the high seas. So the EEZs, or exclusive economic zones, go out to about 200 nautical miles, and then beyond that is the high seas. Just to complicate things in terms of marine law, we actually divide the water column of the high seas from the seabed, which is under a different legal regime. The seabed is not this kind of completely flattened plain, though. As you can see from this geological map of the oceans, we have these great plains, but also, which generally look something like this, they're covered in mud. You'll probably think there's not much going on there, but if you notice, there's all sorts of burrows and scrapings on the seabed here, which are all from the life that's actually living in the sediments. And that life is highly diverse. In fact, the peak diversity is somewhere around 1,000 to 3,000 meters deep. There is, of course, a piece of spectacular megafauna here, but I've got to skip over that. But I will tell you, he does advance menacingly on the robot we have down. So, as I said, there are all sorts of other habitats in the deep ocean. I've got a special interest in seamounts, underwater mountains, but we also have canyons, cold water coral reefs, and a whole variety of other habitats and other types of topography in the ocean. This is just some video from the Nazaire Canyon off Portugal. The remarkable thing is, and you're probably straining your eyes to see this, but this is a table from a report we recently produced for the European Marine Board, is just how little of this habitat has actually been explored. So up here, we've got the deep sea floor, and you'll see proportion investigated 0.0001%. And if we're dealing with the water column, it's much less than 0.0001%. At best, the best studied deep sea ecosystems are ironically deep sea hot springs or hydrothermal vents. And here we probably at least found about a third of these particular features on the seafloor. These were only discovered in the late 1970s. If we look at records of species in the oceans, and these are records from the Ocean Biogeographic Information System, there's something like 22 million records here. What we find is that as we go down in depth, basically the number of species actually sampled dramatically falls between the surface and about 1 kilometer depth. And then when we get down to about 4 or 5 kilometers depth, again, we see a big, big decrease in the number of species records. So our knowledge of this system is actually really, really poor. Having said that, we are making advances in understanding this system. And this is a recent paper by Woolley et al., which was published just last year, where they looked at a data set of these types of creatures. These are brittle stars from all around the deep ocean. And they found that there seemed to be a relationship between the diversity of these brittle stars and the amount of food essentially falling into the deep ocean. So that wasn't a particularly surprising discovery, but it did show a strong contrast to what drives diversity in shallow water, which seems to be temperature. The other thing we should bear in mind about this ecosystem is because it is so vast, it does carry out some important services for the Earth system and therefore for humankind. And we've only got the barest grip on some of these ecosystem services. So up here you can see provisioning services, things like carbon dioxide sequestration and storage, production of food via fisheries and so on. For some of these, we've actually got a fairly good idea of the sort of financial importance and value of those ecosystem services produced by the deep ocean. But you'll see for by far the bulk of these different ecosystem services, in fact, we have very, very little idea. So this is an area of science which is only just beginning. We're barely in a position of understanding even what some of these services are, let alone how important the role of the deep ocean is in them. So unfortunately, humans already have quite a long history of exploiting deep sea resources. And I call some of these industries legacy industries, and the one that I've worked the most on is deep sea fishing. And here we see one of the main targets for some of these deep water fisheries. This is one of my favorite fish, the orange roughy. But just look at some of these statistics here. These fish don't mature to reproduce until they're 30 or 40 years old. They live for more than 150 years. Unfortunately, they also aggregate to spawn over places like seamounts, so it's very easy for the fishing industry to find these fish and to exploit them. And you'll see here the trend in mean catches of the European fleet from 1950 to 2010. And what you can see here is that over the last 30 to 40 years, fishing has been moving into deeper and deeper water. And this is just one example of the type of catastrophic overfishing that can happen when you actually target a species with this type of life history. So this was an orange roughy fishery to the west of Ireland. As you can see, there were catches coming in the early 1990s. And the Irish government then decided to invest, i.e. subsidise, the regearing of some of their fishing fleet to catch these fish. And this happened in about 2000, and by 2003, the fishery had collapsed. So not only was this an ecological catastrophe, but you also had a lot of very angry fishermen because they'd all obviously invested as well in this form of fishing and the resource was gone. The other problem with this type of fishing are its environmental side effects. So the way you catch orange roughy is because the orange roughy dive for the seabed as soon as they perceive danger, you use bottom trawls. And the habitats the orange roughy occur over also host spectacular ecosystems like this. This is a deep water coral reef at more than 1,000 meters on seamounts to the south of Tasmania. This is a seamount in the same area, but one that's actually been trawled for orange roughy and a number of other fish species. And what you can see here is the coral framework, which was certainly there, has been totally obliterated by that trawling activity. And as we're discovering now, some of these corals probably live for more than 4,000 years. That's an individual coral colony. This is in the case of things like black corals and octocorals. These are not reforming corals, but they do form habitats in the deep ocean. So here you see a map of the seamounts, or the estimated position of seamounts that are more than 1,000 meters in terms of their topographic relief. You can see that this is actually quite a common and in terms of aerial extent, important habitat in the deep ocean. So we estimated that there's over 33,000 of these features. So somehow we've got to estimate the risk to these ecosystems from these deep sea fishing activities. And one way that this has been done is to use essentially habitat suitability modeling. These are forms of statistics we use essentially, which look at where corals have been found over large spatial scales, and to look at the correlation with the types of environment in which they're found, and then use that to predict where the corals occur in places we haven't sampled. And you can see the hot red areas here are where coral habitats have been predicted to occur. And this is the Southwest Indian Ocean, where there has been virtually no sampling undertaken, or at least there hadn't been until we went out there with a big ship and a deep sea robot, essentially, to go and investigate these seamounts and to really figure out whether these modeling methods gave us any information about where these habitats actually occurred. The first thing that you'll probably realize from looking at these photographs is that this type of research is not cheap. These vessels are upwards of £30,000 a day to send out to sea. This type of equipment, that was probably £2 to £3 million to build, and has a team of up to 10 engineers, pilots, and so on to run the vehicle. So this is big science. So we went to the Southwest Indian Ridge, where we predicted these corals would turn up, and I can tell you very happily that we did find cold water coral reefs there. And this was despite the existence of deep water fisheries in the region. And these particular cold water coral reefs were located on a seamount where a group of fishing companies had got together, realized they were getting high coral bycatch, and had declared the place a voluntary closed area. So this is not all of the bad news story. And we found all sorts of other wonderful habitats on these seamounts as well. Many of the species we found were new to science. And I just love these Venus basket sponges here. Inside every single one of those sponges is a male and a female shrimp, which are trapped in those sponges forever. So it's obviously some sort of symbiotic relationship between the sponges and shrimps. But it's just a really wonderful example of you know, evolution of this type of relationship in the deep sea. Unfortunately, we also found the signs of all sorts of other fishing activity going on these seamounts. This is on a seamount called Melville Bank. Maybe we can have the lights down a little bit here. And what you can see, what you can see here are big toes of lobster pots. This is at a depth of several hundred meters on the seamount. But I tell you that to get to this seamount, you've got to steam more or less at full speed for 4 or 5 days from the nearest land. It will tell you just how remote some of these habitats are that have been targeted by fishing. There was absolutely no knowledge of this fishery at all connected with these seamounts. And what they're after are these chaps. This is Jasus, a large spiny lobster. And there were a few left, fortunately, on the summits of these seamounts, but clearly there had been some significant effort put into fishing. Here is another one in rather less fortunate circumstances. The other thing we found evidence of on these seamounts was ghost fishing. And this is where this deep sea fishing gear is lost. And unfortunately, it carries on fishing when it's left in the deep ocean. So this lobster will die and it will start to rot. And that will attract in more scavengers, which then themselves get caught in the nets. So there were some fairly grim findings from this trip. And of course, where there's fishing going on, there's various bits of rubbish also being thrown over the side. This is from another seamount, Sattler Bank. And you can see a fisherman's glove here lying on the seabed, several hundred meters again. And obviously, there's a bit of a mixed message because this eel has made it its home. There was a very important finding, which was peripheral to the original objectives of this cruise, which was the discovery of large amounts of essentially debris in the deep ocean. You can see here, this is a paper from one of the postdocs who was involved in this project, where looking at the Southwest Indian Ridge down here, and comparing it to seamounts and deep sea areas in the North Atlantic, you can see the types of rubbish are quite different here between these two areas. The reason for that is a lot of this is coming from cruise liners and container ships and so on, just chucking stuff overboard. And here, a lot of the debris is coming from fishing vessels. The story didn't stop there, though. What we found when we started to look at deep sea sediment samples from these seamounts, and these were samples down to 1,500 meters, was the presence of plastic microfibers in all of those samples, and also even draped on the deep sea animals which we were collecting. So you can see here, these are, this is again locations from our seamount cruise, and then we have the North Atlantic and Mediterranean, and the different types of plastic microfiber which were being found. This was a completely new finding, and suggests that a significant proportion of the so-called missing plastic in the budgets of this stuff, as it's lost into the ocean, then ends up either floating on the surface or washed up on shores, was actually going into the deep sea. And what it was probably doing was becoming attached to the sinking marine snow or dead plankton cells and so on into the deep ocean. And basically these fibers are becoming tangled up in this material. We've been doing some work recently, and this hasn't been published yet, so I'm not putting any statistics or anything up which is likely to end up in a paper, but two of my DPhil students, Jesse van der Griendt and Oliver Ashford, have been looking at the world's largest sample set from the deep sea ever taken, and this was taken in the Northwest Atlantic. And what we're finding here is that although we've been looking at soft sediment communities, which you'd think, well, there's not a lot going on here, what we're finding here is that fishing can actually have the effect of increasing the abundance of animals in these sediments. But the functional diversity of those communities is actually being decreased by fishing. In other words, trawling really is structuring the benthic communities, or the seabed communities that live in this area. So moving on to a new industry, and that's deep sea mining. And if you look at these vent chimneys, this is what they're made of. This is copper pyrite, okay? Or this is one of the things they're made of. These vent deposits contain high quantities of copper, nickel, even things like gold and silver. And therefore, they're becoming of interest as a new source for minerals. And in fact, this is a deep sea mining machine, which at present is on its way out to Papua New Guinea to perhaps start the first deep sea mining operation in the world at a depth of about 1.6 kilometers. There are various potential deposits in the deep sea which are being looked at for these types of mining practices. And this type of activity is regulated by a UN body, the International Seabed Authority. And of course, there are potential serious impacts associated with this type of activity. And here is a graphic representation of what those may be. Obviously, if you're digging up the hydrothermal vent field, there's a direct impact, but also potential impacts in terms of release of material into the water column and so on. If we look at the fauna on hydrothermal vents around the world, we find that it is distinct in different regions, but there are similarities as well. So what you see here, vents from the Indian Ocean, which have these huge swarms of shrimp. These are vents from the Atlantic, which have a very, very closely related form of shrimp, suggesting some sort of biogeographic connectivity between these two areas. And the other thing to mention is the fauna of these vents is highly endemic. Something like 70% or more in terms of the level of endemism in these communities. In other words, more than 70% of these organisms are not found anywhere else. So we wanted to have a look at this potential connectivity between oceans, and the obvious place to find it was the Southern Ocean, which is the ocean that connects the other major oceans in the world. And we had some evidence that there were hydrothermal vents down here on the East Scotia Ridge, which is to the southeast of South Georgia. And we went there to look for them, and we found hydrothermal vents in this region. And you'll see here, this is the ridge, and in both cases, the vents were associated with bulges on the East Scotia Ridge. In other words, there's a mantle chamber underneath the ridge at these points, and that's what's generating the heat to drive these systems. Incidentally, we also found an entire submarine caldera, which had been previously unmapped, and this just goes to demonstrate just how poorly mapped the oceans are. So we went to these hydrothermal vents, and what we found really surprised us. These looked nothing like any other hydrothermal vent that had been found. We had enormous numbers of these Yeti crabs. And essentially what these crabs do is, you'll see they have furry undersides, and they grow chemosynthetic bacteria on this fur, which they then comb off and eat. And when I say chemosynthetic bacteria, they're bacteria which are oxidizing chemicals in the hydrothermal vent fluid to generate energy for carbon fixation. So as you can see, there's a lot of chemical energy and therefore lots of animals, up to about 4,000 to 6,000, I think, per square meter in this case. There were also other organisms, these large snails, for example, which had the symbiotic bacteria in their tissues. All of these animals were new to science, but not just at the species level, some at genus level and some at family level. So what really surprised us was not just what was found at these vents, but what wasn't found. So many of the organisms we were expecting to find simply weren't there. And the conclusion from this was that the polar front was acting as a kind of variable filter to the hydrothermal vent fauna. And because probably of reasons of life history, some species simply could not live in the very, very cold waters of the Antarctic, or at least live through all their life stages. So another interesting side point here was that this single 4 to 5 week cruise changed our idea of how the hydrothermal vent fauna was distributed around the world. And each one of these different symbols represents a particular type of hydrothermal vent community. And we estimated there are around 11 distinct types of community globally. So moving back to the Indian Ocean and talking about mining, what you see here are basically exploratory mining prospects for various states on the high seas of the Indian Ocean or in the area. This is an area which has been licensed to China for exploration. We've got another area up here, which I think is Korea, an area here for India and so on. So it looks as though there's a bit of a gold rush going on in this area. And this is some of the first video obtained of the hydrothermal vents on the southwest Indian Ridge. And you'll see these are fairly spectacular looking structures. This is a beehive smoker. Again, at great depth, these are around 3,000 meters or so. And if you just bear with me. And see some of these shrimps here. And also snails, which looked very, very like those that we were getting in the Southern Ocean. In fact, it turned out to be a very, very closely related species. And in a second, you'll see one of the other familiar characters from the Southern Ocean, a Yeti crab that again was very, very closely related. And I'll just point to these. These are the only animals which secrete iron armor. So these scales are actually made of iron. These are what we call scaly foot snails, and they're an Indian Ocean speciality. So as I said, the discovery here was the fact that we were picking up some sort of connection between the Southern Ocean and the Southwest Indian Ocean. So we've looked at this further, and as Akin said, last year I did a dive with the Japanese and the RV Yokosuka using this vehicle. This is a 27-ton submersible. It's capable of diving to 6.5 kilometers. This is what it looks like from the inside. Oh, you'll see all you get is a kind of 20-centimeter porthole to look through, because of course at this depth there's about 330 atmospheres of pressure sitting outside of this titanium hull. And the vents we saw on the central Indian ridge, look, they do have some similarities to the ones on the southwest Indian ridge. So you can see the hydrothermal vent shrimps here. This is another vent field, a deeper one in the same area. And again, these vast swarms of shrimps, but also some of the scaly foot snails and other animals we were familiar with from the southwest Indian Ridge. And to cut a long story short, when we looked at the genetic connectivity of these two regions, so the southwest Indian Ridge and the central Indian Ridge, what you can see here, this is a sort of graphic way of presenting this genetic information. The white colors here from the southwest Indian Ridge, and you can see that they're not mixed or virtually not mixed at all with the haplotypes from the central Indian Ridge. In other words, there was almost no genetic connectivity and therefore no dispersal between these two vent fields. So I'd just finish up really with a couple of things. The first one is that at the moment, we're actually in a period of negotiation for a new implementing agreement for the UN Convention on Law of the Sea. And this is meant to plug some really serious gaps in how we protect the high seas and the area, which is a seabed underneath them. So you see at the moment, there is no legal framework for setting up protected areas on the high seas. And one of the aims of this implementing agreement is to try and get that framework together. There is also no consistent framework for assessing the potential impact of industrial activities in the deep ocean of the high seas, and also no agreement around marine genetic resources. And yet, we have requirements under recent international agreements to protect at least 10% of this habitat through spatial protection measures. What are we actually doing at the moment in the light of I guess some positive and some grim news, is we're moving into a large-scale investigation of how life is distributed in the deep ocean, and particularly in the zone between 200 and 2,000 metres. And the reason for this is that it's that zone where we get the peak in species richness in the deep sea, and also many of these hotspot ecosystems in the deep ocean. We completed our first mission this summer around Bermuda, and we used a very new type of submersible for this work. And you'll see them here. This is actually a submersible which is built for the owners of super yachts. You can buy one of these with about $1 million a piece. But the interesting thing about them is the whole pressure hull is made of acrylic, which gives you the most fantastic view of these deep water ecosystems and really enables you to understand the system both geologically and biologically. On this expedition, we found to everyone's surprise on Bermuda, some really remarkable deep water habitats. This is a dense field of black corals on the slopes of Bermuda. Another example here, this is a field of algae at about 70 or 80 meters deep on a seamount. This is called Spirochnus, this stuff, completely covered the seamount. And we found several new species of algae at these mesophotic depths, which have been so poorly sampled. And you'll see the submersible there being blown about like a kite, because one of the things about these seamounts is because water has to move over them, then you get these very, very strong currents. So the idea really is to investigate the different predicted biophysical zones in this depth range. You can see them here in red and noted on the map here in red. And our intention is to visit all of these 14 bioregions, which have essentially been predicted by comparing the different physical characteristics of the ocean in these different areas. So just to summarize, we're still really in the exploratory phase of deep sea biology. Human exploitation and pollution have already impacted or contaminated the deep ocean. First vent fields discovered in the Antarctic really changed our view of the biogeography of these habitats. As I said, we've got evidence of faunal connections and lack of connections between these different areas, which is very relevant in terms of management. The largest ecosystem on Earth is a global commons and still very, very poorly protected. Okay, and that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah, that would be great. So, Alex, thank you very much. Fascinating journey. I mean, the topic of oceans has obviously been one that I think many of us, and I personally also, have paid a great deal of attention to. But I would say much of what you have shown today, to me, was really new terrain and new frontiers, as you yourself saw. So thank you for taking us to a frontier that is, in a sense, odd that we should still consider it such a frontier in terms of knowledge and research. And I have said about destroying it before we even understood that it exists and carries life in forms that we have not even known, which is perhaps one of our great challenges in trying to take the research frontier on oceans and marine ecosystems forward, while economics is knocking on the door every day, but in terms of fisheries or deep sea bed mining. Colleagues, the floor is open. I think Alex will take a number of questions, and if I could invite you, we have microphones also. Just briefly introduce yourself and then take advantage of his presence. Thank you. Can we start there on the left? Just a second. We needed to use the microphone so that the live web can follow you.
Hi, I'm Richard Thomas. I'm an old geologist, very old geologist. What is the rationale of the organization that is granting these licenses to countries such as China and India? What's their rationale for doing that?
Well, the way the International Seabed Authority was set up, it was set up as a result of another implementing agreement for the UN Convention on Law of the Sea. And the aim of it was to try and manage the spread of a new activity of deep sea mining, but at the same time to set up an infrastructure to share the profits of that activity amongst the global community. And of course, this is the high seas, it's a global commons, the common heritage of humankind, the words that we hear used quite frequently. The problem is that, of course, this is a very difficult activity to manage when these operations are going on so far from shore. And I can actually tell you that we intended to visit the Southwest Indian Ridge during this cruise, and the Chinese vessels were actually present over that ridge and were very obstructive in us actually doing work there. So we never actually got to go to that particular ridge. Now, of course, that, you know, in legal terms is clearly not on, but when it's put to you that your submersible might be down and have a collision with their robot that's down, obviously people don't want to take that type of risk. So what goes on in the halls of the International Seabed Authority in Jamaica and what actually happens out at sea is quite difficult sometimes to reconcile. And a good example of that is there's been a recent story in the papers about the essentially plunder of war graves down in the southwest Pacific by unknown salvage vessels. So actually monitoring what's going on out in these areas is difficult. The International Seabed Authority does have a tough job. I mean, it's got to get all these states to agree on regulations for this mining. They've got very finite resources to monitor and manage that activity. And the scientific community is trying to input what it can in terms of the environmental impact assessment. But how all this is going to work practically, I think, is yet to be seen.
You mentioned millions of tons of plastic going into the sea. We've known for some time there are actually bacteria that can digest polyethylene-type plastics, mm-hmm. and more recently, ones that can digest harder plastics, and the polyethylene-type ones have probably been around for a long time. Others, there's interesting speculation, they may have evolved since we started dumping the newer plastics. They're found especially in the guts of many marine animals. Right. Does this mean that the ecosystem is kind of learning to cope with our debris?
That's a good question. I have no answer for it. but what I would say is that what you've got to bear in mind about these deep ocean areas is that temperatures are very low. And that means that, you know, biological activity is likely to take place at a fairly low rate. That's why many of these organisms are extremely long-lived, for example. So, you know, if those activities are taking place, they will be taking place at a much slower pace in the deep ocean. The other big question we've got is whether there's any actual biological effect of this material in the environment. And there has been the suggestion that these plastics absorb pollutants, organic pollutants, onto their surfaces. And there's a big question at the moment as to whether those substances remain attached to the plastic as it passes through the body of these animals, or whether it's released into the tissue of the animals as they're digesting, you know, their food. There's a lot of work going on this at the moment. The issues with that work is it's been done on a whole variety of organisms, all using different methods, and comparing one study to another is really, really difficult. So.
Thank you. Colleagues, other questions? Intrigued?
One at the back.
Perplexed?
Hi there, thank you for a fascinating presentation. I think I might speak for many people when I say the Yeti crow is my new favorite animal. my name's Lucy Goodman, I'm from Earthwatch, and as an environmental charity, we try and inspire action through knowledge. So my question for you is, you know, having been so inspired by your presentation, how can we take action to avoid some of these impacts that you've highlighted?
Well, that's a very, very good question. And I've attended, you know, various meetings where scientists talk to each other and actually frighten each other sometimes. The key is to try and get political action into making change. And of course, politicians have a very long list of things to deal with. So the question is how to push some of these themes sort of higher on their agenda. And the only way to do that is by increasing public awareness. Now, that is quite difficult, particularly if you're constantly, you know, almost providing a bad news story. People do eventually just switch off, you know, don't want to hear another bad news story about the Great Barrier Reef or whatever it is. And this is one of the reasons why in Necton we're particularly keen to put people actually down in these submersibles, because it's getting that human element of people actually in the deep sea and witnessing these ecosystems firsthand, which can really capture the public's imagination, but also tailored with this particular project is a really extensive STEM educational program, which is being delivered straight into schools. Tomorrow I'm talking to a class of 100 teachers, trainee teachers, and really one of the keys to this is education of young people. It's a bit harder to educate, you know, people as old as I am, but certainly to get at young people and to really, you know, fill them with fascination and love for these this type of ecosystem and even the technology and so on is a good way to try and start to change people's opinion and get them to pressure politicians.
Well, it's a very interesting story, and when you look at the fish that are being caught in the benthos and off the continental shelf, and then immediately you talk about the sulfur vents, etc., contaminating the seawater with heavy metal sulfides and other toxic materials, surely these materials will end up in those fish. So they'll make them really uncommercial.
The metals that are produced around those vents largely settle out around the hydrothermal vents. And that's why they're actually being targeted. It's for the what we call seabed massive sulfides. Things like iron are, you know, dispersed over a much larger area. In fact, there's evidence now for the southern ocean where iron is a limiting nutrient for primary production, that a significant portion of the iron that's contributing towards primary production in the southern ocean is actually coming from vents. So that's just one example of how complex these systems are and how we're being surprised all the time. Where there are real problems with bioaccumulation or biomagnification is actually largely connected with human activity. So there are some heavy metals which do accumulate towards the top of the food chain, and mercury is the classic one. And in large pelagic fish, basically top predators in the ocean, there are naturally quite high levels of mercury. But when you add to that the mercury that's being input from things like coal-fired power stations, then you start to get levels which are rising towards the stage where they're going to become a problem. I, for one, just don't eat big fish like that at all. I stick with the small guys, which are a lot more healthy to eat.
The big fish, thank you.
Yes.
If I don't see, we have a couple more. So one at the back, then we'll come to you.
Hi, thank you very much for a very fascinating talk. I was wondering, so you mentioned that an outing was really expensive, so £30,000 a day, was it, for the boat?
Yeah, something like that.
What motivates you? What makes you choose a certain location when you plan an outing? What sort of question drives the research, essentially?
Well, it is largely driven, obviously, by scientific questions. I mean, in the case of the Southern Ocean, as I said, what we were trying to figure out was how fauna disperses between the Indian, Atlantic, and Pacific Oceans. And that was the key site, excuse me, to go and investigate that question, because we knew there were vents there. Those plumes release material up into the water column, and you can detect that material, particularly things like helium, from quite a distance from the vents. The other thing that propels me into an area is just how little it's actually been studied as well. So my ideal combination is an excellent scientific question and a place where no one else has been before. That fills me with lots of excitement. And that's how we've ended up in places like the Southwest Indian Ocean. We knew there'd been deep water fishing there. We predicted using our models that there were cold water coral reefs or potentially cold water coral reefs there. We wanted to test the models. what better way to do that than to go to a place in the ocean which has simply never been looked at.
Thank you. There was a lady here at the front.
Thank you. Thanks very much. That was fascinating. My question also starts with the point of the expense of the research and the difficulty in finding appropriate funds. I know that in Australia, the research vessels are also partly used for commercial activities to help fund them.
Yeah.
And I wondered whether you've had any discussions or whether there's any openings potentially for accessing some of the research that goes on through commercial exploratory activities, whether those doors are always completely shut to scientific sharing of knowledge.
We do actually often use data gathered from commercial vessels. I'll give you an example of that. We were interested in coral distribution around South Georgia in the South Atlantic or Southern Ocean Atlantic sector. And there, we used data on coral bycatch from fishing vessels to actually figure out where the corals were, and again, to do some predictive modeling and figure out where the habitats, types of habitats might be, where those corals were occurring. There are huge amounts of environmental impact assessment data out there for things like the oil industry. Our problem often is the way in which those data are collected. If we have data where, you know, we know that the biological material has been nicely collected, we can identify that, and that's been collected with the right types of environmental data, that becomes a very powerful data set. And indeed, the work that Oliver and Jesse have been doing was the result of an industry collaboration between several states, Canada, Spain, and the UK were involved, to actually do that work off the Scotian shelf. And in that case, there was very, very careful thought about how those samples were taken. As a result, we can really do some powerful analysis and figure out exactly what is driving the composition of the seabed communities in that area. So watch this space. There's some exciting research on the way out on that.
I think you had your hand up. Maybe the last two. I saw one more hand in the back. Have I overlooked anyone? Okay, so the last two.
Fascinating, of course, that you've given us there. You haven't mentioned particularly much about climate change, global warming effects on the ocean. It's a huge subject, I know.
Yeah.
Are you there rather stymied perhaps by lack of knowledge, means you don't have a comparator enough to judge how much effect
likely to be occurring? I've written an entire review paper on that topic for the Deep Ocean, which was published in 2015 in Annual Review of Environment and Resources. And clearly there are going to be climate change impacts on the deep sea, some of which are likely to feed back to the atmosphere in terms of CO2 being recycled from the ocean to the atmosphere. The problem is that many of those processes we can barely identify, and we certainly don't have good quantification of the rates of those processes in the deep ocean and whether there's going to be a positive or negative feedback in terms of CO2 uptake as a result of some of these processes in deep water ecosystems. Some of the things we do know is the deep ocean has absorbed by far the largest proportion of heat from the atmosphere as a result of CO2 emissions, something like 80 or 90% of the excess heat as a result of emissions is ending up in the deep sea. So the prospect of warming in these communities is certainly a real one. And some of the results we've got coming through from the NUREDA project are going to have quite a lot of bearing on our understanding of what the response of biological communities in the deep sea will be to temperature rise. One of the obvious things is that as temperature goes up, metabolic rate goes up and organisms become less efficient at assimilating carbon to tissue. So there's a big loss in terms of biomass potentially.
Thank you. Yes, the last hand was up.
The gentleman's question was just asked.
Ah, okay. Right, okay.
Okay, then let's, sorry, we have one question here. Just ask me quickly, then Clara doesn't have to come all the way from the back.
Can you comment then on deoxygenation and changing pH in the oceans as a result of anthropogenic pollution?
Yeah, these are the sort of climate change three riders of the apocalypse, I call them. It's temperature rise, hypoxia, and acidification. Acidification obviously is the result of CO2 uptake by the ocean. It dissolves and forms carbonic acid, which alters the carbonate equilibrium in seawater. And that's a big problem for animals which make their shells out of calcium carbonate. So crustaceans, mollusks, various plankton species and so on. So far, we've seen a change of pH of about 0.1, but of course it's a log scale. So that's about a 30% increase in hydrogen ions, which is a significant change. And we are seeing biological effects in certainly in the shallow ocean. In the deep ocean, we haven't really got the baseline measurements to estimate the impact of that on deep sea organisms. Hypoxia is a real issue in some parts of the deep ocean. There are extreme oxygen minimum zones, places like the Arabian Sea, and a likely result of ocean warming, of course, is you get less mixing of the ocean, less oxygen, not only being mixed into the deep ocean, but less oxygen being carried in seawater simply because it's warmer. So we're likely to see expansion of those hypoxic zones. The large-scale consequences of that are hard to predict at the moment. Certainly in upwelling zones, that can be a real problem. So there have been issues off Oregon with major spills of extremely hypoxic and acidic water onto the shelf, which caused large kills of marine life, and similar problems off South Africa as well.
Alex, thank you very much for a remarkable hour with you on the frontiers of research, and almost feeling as if you were part of your vessel for some of the journey. I just want to pick up on one point which was made about what do we do about this? Because in some ways it is testimony to, you know, modern humankind's ignorance while acting, isn't it? I mean, if I recall just 200-300 years ago, as seafarers arrived off the coast of North America, they were writing accounts of going up up the coast and literally being able to put buckets in the water and pull fish out in order to feed themselves.
Yeah.
And in less than 80 years, we have managed to take fisheries across the global oceans to the point of collapse or maximum use. That would have been unimaginable. So you pointed to something that I think perhaps is where we should all pay some more attention, which is a well-intentioned instrument, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, was an expression, when is it, almost 30 years ago,
yeah,
of nations recognizing that there was a commons out there that was not going to be managed properly and actually already was predicted to be the frontier for the next economy. Some people refer to it as the blue economy. I'm not sure that's how it is meant by the small island developing states who have now taken this term up. But I can tell you from experience, it is a very bizarre phenomenon, because in the years leading up to the 2012 summit in Rio, Sustainable Development Summit, Secretary General Ban Ki-moon actually tried to launch an ocean compact to draw attention to the urgency of getting nations to act. This compact was deliberately and systematically sunk by the most unusual alliance of countries, from Iceland to the US to Argentina, Spain, for a very simple reason. An alliance of interests that are in part driven by military security interests, which we should not underestimate, and secondly, by the frontiers of mineral exploration and exploitation in the future, in which countries at the moment would rather not have any change happening under international law in order to keep all options open or to ensure that others do not have access to something that they may not wish to share. And I would say, you know, it is worth examining one's own country's stance on this. And sometimes it's even landlocked countries who play a very active role in this. Bizarre. So I would urge you to look at this, because that instrument was meant to be humanity's commitment to sharing the responsibility for conserving and sustainably managing and using the oceans. Unfortunately, in its current interpretation and how it is being applied, it has actually turned into perhaps a risk to the future of the oceans, because it's actually legitimizing paralysis and inaction. And it's unforgivable in my mind, and I can say that perhaps in ways that you can't. And I think it needs our attention. Just like, you know, fishermen may celebrate Brexit around the UK because now they can go out and fish. The question is, where is that fish going to come from? I mean, it doesn't change flags when it swims from the EU into UK waters, and vice versa, not out. And yet that perception is there that we can still manage marine resources along national boundaries, whether it's EEZs or other such artificially drawn lines. And that's why I think your research is so critical with many others. First of all, open our eyes to the extraordinary life that is down there. Secondly, the vulnerability it faces. And thirdly, the opportunities for actually doing something about it. So, Alex, thank you for being with us this evening and for continuing to drive that kind of research forward. I know I was supposed to announce, sorry, Jim, just give me the paper. Our next two lectures. Thank you. Just to say that we will have on the 16th of February at 5 o'clock here, Professor Sir Chris Llewellyn-Smith, who is the Director of Energy Research here with us in Oxford, and he will lecture us on Can Future Energy Needs Be Met Sustainably? 5 o'clock on the 16th. And then, since there were questions on climate change, we have somebody who has just emerged out of Washington. I teased her whether she was on asylum search here in the UK at Oxford. Karen Floridi, who was very much central in much of America's negotiations around the Paris Agreement. The former US Deputy Special Envoy for Climate Change, who is a visiting fellow with us. And Karen Floridi will lecture here on climate change. What's new? What's next? Very ominous questions to ask at this moment in time. And that will be on the 21st of February, please note, at 12:30 to 1400 here at the Martin School. And finally, we will have Dr. Gordon Menzies, also an Oxford Martin visiting fellow, associate professor in economics, discipline group at the University of Technology in Sydney, on restoring trust in finance, moral obligation meets Econ 101. Tuesday, 21st, 5 o'clock here at the Oxford Martin School, followed by drinks. That must be the financial sector being revolved.
Yes.
Alex, a great round of applause. Thank you very much.